Hello, this is Keir from Zenforo. 11 years ago, when Zenforo was a very new application, I produced a series of videos showing how to use some of the Ajax functionality built into Zenforo, like opening links in overlays and updating page content without a full reload for your own features. I'd like to think that those videos helped kickstart the development of the truly amazing wealth of third-party add-ons that are now available for Zenforo. Recently, I was asked how much of the information in those videos, which was put together when the active version of Zenforo was 1.0, is still relevant and applicable now to Zenforo 2.2. Despite the fact that very little of the first generation code still exists in Zenforo 2, the answer is surprisingly quite a bit. Most of the code syntax changed in the transition to version 2, but a lot of the principles in use in those videos remain essentially the same today. Back when Zenforo 2 debuted, we produced a written tutorial to help add-on developers get used to the new system, but we've never done a video series on the subject. Watching those old videos again made me think that we should have one, so I've been putting together a whole new series, starting with the very basics of getting an add-on started and digging deep into some of the tools and features at your disposal when building with Zenforo. To follow these videos, I'm going to assume that you have a relatively decent understanding of the languages in which Zenforo is written, namely PHP, JavaScript, HTML5, and CSS3. You're also going to need to know the ins and outs of object-oriented programming in both PHP and JavaScript, or some of the stuff I'm going to be demonstrating will seem like total gobbledygook. It's also important that you're fairly familiar with the Zenforo system from a user and an administrator perspective, so a brush up with the manual would be helpful if you're a bit rusty or if you're coming from a much older version of Zenforo. Also, keep the Zenforo developer docs handy as they can be a great reference, and in most cases they can go into a lot more detail than I can in a video. If you'd like to work along with the videos, you'll need a developer environment that can run Zenforo, and ideally you'll have access to the absolutely indispensable Xdebug as part of that process. If you don't have it already, we have setup tutorials for Mac, Windows and Linux in the developer docs appendices. I hope that you'll find these videos useful and informative. And if there's a particular topic you'd like to see covered in a future video, or if you're unclear about something covered in any of these, go ahead and start a discussion over at the Zenforo.com community forums. Before we get started, we're going to need to assemble our toolkit. And the tools we require at this point are a code editor. I'm using PHP Storm here, but you could use Visual Studio Code or Eclipse or whatever else floats your boat. But I would recommend that you use something that understands PHP. It's going to make your life a lot easier. Then we need something with which to interface with the database. I'm using Table Plus here, but anything will do unless you really fancy getting down and dirty with a terminal. And of course, we need a properly installed and configured version of Zenforo. This is version 2.2.5 in its current state, and I'm running it on the latest version of PHP. Because I think that's really important to make sure that you're working with the latest available tools and that you don't accidentally use functions that have been deprecated in later versions that will come back to bite you later on. I've got MariaDB handling MySQL duties, and the whole thing's held together with Nginx. So we're all just about get ready to get started now, with the exception of Zenforo itself, which is currently running in non-development mode. Development mode opens up a bunch of additional tools and facilities to allow you to work with new add-ons. So let's go and turn that on. We'll head over to our code editor, and in the source directory of your Zenforo installation, you'll find the config file. You may not have touched this. This may have been automatically written out for you as part of the installation process, but at this point, we need to go and manually edit it. We're going to add a new configuration directory, and it looks like this. We're going to have config development enabled equals true. And when I save that out and refresh the Zenforo window, we're going to find that a new development navigation entry appears, and it gives us a bunch of additional tools to do our job. So now let's take the first steps to getting this add-on built. I'm going to need a terminal for this. I've got one here built into PHP Storm, but the one that's built into your operating system will be fine. And what we're going to do is we're going to run a command from your Zenfora directory, which in my case is development www tutorial. And the command looks like this. PHP command.php xf-addon colon. This is the command that wraps up nearly all of our add-on related commands. And the command we want to run is add-on create. Now, there are no additional arguments for this command at this point. We can just let that run, and it asks me for an ID for the add-on. Well, let's talk about the ID. If we head into the add-ons directory within the source folder here, you can see that we've got the standard XF add-on, which is where all of the templates and stuff for Zenfora itself lives. And then we've got XFI, which is the Zenfora importers, and XFES, the enhanced search add-on. These ones have their stuff sitting directly under the directory, but we also have this demo folder, and within demo is portal. And if you've ever looked at the Zenfora developer docs, there is a tutorial there for how to build an add-on, and this is the add-on that we built, the portal. And the portal sits within this demo directory, which makes the ID of it ever so slightly more complicated. So in the interest of covering all bases, we're going to do the slightly more complicated version. So if I were adding something that is going to live at the root level, then I could just say pad is going to be the ID of my add-on, but I don't want that today. I want to make it a child of this demo thing. So if you were planning to produce a collection of add-ons, for example, you might want them all to live within one directory. So we're going to call this demo slash pad. We're going to do some sort of notepad, scratch pad thing. I haven't quite worked out where it's going to go yet, but it's really just a technology demo, so it doesn't matter. So my add-on is going to be demo pad, and then we want a title. So something appropriate would be demo scratch pad notepad thingy. Okay, now our version ID. The version ID just needs to be a number that will get bigger as your versions get newer. So if you release version 25, then that doesn't necessarily have to have a version ID of 25, it just needs to have an ID of something that's bigger than version 24. I'm going to be using the Zenfora numbering system, which is encoded using a collection of digits, and I'm going to start at 1.00 alpha, and that code is 1000010. And when I enter that, it will automatically detect that that's Zenfora numbering system and set the version string. If you use your own version numbering system, like just a single integer, it will ask you to describe what that version means so that it can be presented on screen. So that's really up to you. Next question, does this add-on supersede Zenfora 1 add-on? Nope, haven't done one of these before. And now the add-on JSON's written out. And does your add-on need a setup file? Yes, it will, because we're going to be creating database tables and things later on, and those will need to be created in the setup file for when we redistribute our add-on. So yes, we do. And does the setup need to support running multiple steps? Probably, so we might as well say yes. Okay, it's done. And if we come up here, we'll find that it creates a new pad folder under there, containing the setup.php, which contains the various traits that contain the behaviors for running multiple steps, etc. We'll come back to that later on. And addon.json, which contains the other information that we provided during this little setup wizard. Now, if we head over to the add-ons section here, my demo scratchpad notepad thingy version 1.00 alpha has appeared with this puzzle piece icon. We can change that icon with this little command here, this little piece of the JSON array. I'm going to use this icon here from Font Awesome, so I'll just copy that, and then we need to use the CSS class that corresponds to that, which is fa dash, and then the bit I just copied. Save that, come back to Zenfora and refresh, And there we go. So it knows that it's already installed because the add-on is automatically installed as part of the creation process. There's the icon, and we're essentially ready to go. We're going to head over to the template editor now to do one last step before we start building in earnest. So I'm going to head over to templates, and then I want to make sure I'm in the master style. This master style only becomes available once you're in development mode. If I turn off development mode, then the ability to edit the master style also disappears. So we want to be in the master style, and we're going to create a public template. Hit add, and now we should see that near the bottom of the page here, we have the ability to choose our add-on. And we can choose our new add-on from there, which is great, but I can guarantee that at some point during the process of building an add-on, you will forget to pick which add-on it belongs to, because I know I do. But we have a solution for that. We just head back to the config file, and I'm going to take a copy of that line, and instead of having development enabled specified, I'm going to go default add-on, let's spell that correctly, default add-on equals, and then the ID that we just gave it, demo forward slash pad. And now when I go to the add template page, it pre-selects the add-on without me having to worry about it. It's just one less thing that you need to concern yourself about while you're doing your work, so well worth doing that. You just need to remember to turn it off or to switch the add-on that it's pointing to if you move on to a different add-on or you work on something else. So let's see if this works. So the name for my template is just going to be test, but I'm going to sort of namespace it so that it's specifically identified with my particular add-on. Even though it's been attributed to the add-on with this field here, that it, I can prevent collisions with other add-ons by namespacing it with the ID of my add-on as a prefix. What do I mean by that? Well, I'm just going to start all of my template names with demo underscore pad underscore and then the appropriate name. So let's just call it test and then put some test text in there and hit save. And that's created my new template type. And if I pop it over here, you'll see that it creates this new underscore output folder within my pad directory. And inside the templates and public folder is my demo pad test file, which is great. We're going to learn more about that in the next step. But for now, this is good. I can get rid of this test template. And in the next step, we're going to build an actual page to check that everything is all up and running.